way we talk about hobos in the U.S. is a person who rides trains, freight trains around without paying, and for months or years at a time. So it's a way of life that grew up after the Depression era, when lots of people did this to find work. The jobs came, but some people kept living on the trains anyway. And it's up to today, when there's a lot of punk anarchists who still like to travel that way. And when I was traveling that way, the main people working were Mexican migrants, undocumented people who could keep out of sight on freight trains as opposed to buses or highways. So they, in a lot of ways, are the modern day American hobo. And the people I was with always said the best hobos were traveling to work. They don't admire people who are just killing time, but many of them never really looked for work. They were just traveling. So I grew up in Denver, Colorado, which has many train lines going through it. And as I grew up, older boys who I knew would catch those trains and come back with stories. And it sounded very exciting, and I wanted to do it. But I learned as I got older that there's a whole American tradition of writers, from Jack London to Jack Kerouac and Woody Guthrie and others, riding on freight trains kind of as an expression of individuality, of nonconformity. It's a way to live a parallel life on a different clock with different expectations. It's actually a good way to see the United States. You can see a lot of beautiful scenery on trains for free, but it's become more and more difficult, especially since 9/11. The police are more present around freight yards. The fences are taller. The lights come on at night, and it's harder now. It's a freedom to come and go when you please, to go in whatever direction you feel like with whoever you want to be with that day. The problem, I think, for a lot of them is it's also, and anyone who's just visiting, like I was, soon sees that you're also free from a safe place to sleep, protection from the elements. It's very easy to get a train, say, going over mountains during a storm. You can really freeze to death easily. And sometimes kids throw rocks at the trains, and the police are always looking for people riding trains because it's, of course, trespassing. And so there is freedom, but you understand it's within a certain context of having to be careful and cautious and use your head all the time. I was raised in a middle-class family. I had the things I needed growing up, but I often thought, well, what if my life had been different and I hadn't had opportunities like I had, or things went wrong? Could I live in a different way? So it was partly an experiment I devised for myself to see if I could, and also to see if somebody from my particular world could learn about people like them and talk to them and maybe make friends, but at least spend time. My goal was to understand them as well as I could, so I spent 4 months doing this. But the longest relationship was with two guys. It lasted 2 weeks. That was pretty long. Then we had a fight. They took some of my stuff one day. And then you start over. And each time, you have to reestablish a connection and figure out what you have in common with them. One thing that surprised me is they were afraid of me because I'm young. So I'm not a big guy, but to them, it was very strange that a young person would live that way if he had other opportunities. One guy said, "You could go join the military. They'll still take you. What are you doing here?" And so they're afraid you're there to steal from them. So I ended up carrying extra things, like an extra bag, so it looked like I had plenty. and that way they wouldn't be afraid of me. I think I had that in mind in some way, that I could consider myself adult if I were able to do this, if I could manage without help, without calling home, and if I could succeed in, you know, traveling and actually making my way back, I thought, yeah, that would be a good test. And you brought up Into the Wild, John Krakauer's book, which is about a young man who gave up everything. He gave away his money and gave away all his possessions with the idea that in traveling light, I think you come closer to the chance of a spiritual growth or something, that you have to unburden yourself and then you're free. And I like that idea, and I like how easily the hobos I met can leave behind clothes that get dirty. They just leave them, or the sleeping bag, they leave it, and they're confident they'll find something else and the world will provide. And it's a nice idea. It doesn't always work. There's always a few nights you don't have enough blankets, or you're cold because you didn't have a sweater to put on after it rained. And so there is that ascetic ideal, almost like a religious pilgrim going to unknown places or into the wilderness to see what happens. And that was part of the appeal to me, but I'm also realistic enough to know that that kind of journey is very close to poverty. And there's something about poverty that has no romantic appeal to me. When you're sick and you need something, or if somebody has treated you terribly and you're by yourself and you feel bad, that's awful. And that's always close to your thoughts that that could happen. Well, funny you should ask. The day he was born, I thought, I'm in trouble, because I've done all these things. That book on the trains was just the first of several experiences that I can hardly tell him no if I did it. I can't be a hypocrite. So I waited and waited. And when he turned 18, he finally read this book. And he just told me one day offhandedly, "Dad, I read your book." And I said, "Oh, great. What did you think?" And he said, "Oh, it was a good book. I liked it." And I said, "Thank you, thank you." So I thought, okay, that's it. And then about a week later, he said, "Dad, you know, since you rode the trains, can't I ride the trains too?" And I thought, oh, I knew it was coming. But I also had thought of how I would reply. And I said, "Yes, of course. But would you like to do it together?" And I didn't know what he'd say, because it's very different to do this with your father than to do it by yourself. But to my relief, he said, "Yeah, that would be great." And so 2 summers ago, we took a 5-day trip much of it was incredibly fun and exciting. I was out of practice, so I'd forgotten a few things, and a lot has changed since the trip I wrote about in my book. It's harder to get on trains. As I said before, there's police and fences. Our first train we had to catch while it was moving, which is always more difficult, but that's what he wanted to do, because it's like the movies, and he's good at it. And it worked out really well. But he wasn't interested in meeting hobos so much. And after a few days, he had enough. So anyway. Well, I've still had good experiences even with a family. For a year, I worked as a prison guard at Sing Sing, north of New York City. And that book is my best known book in the U.S. And I came home every night. It was a job. And I became a federal meat inspector 2 years ago and worked in a slaughterhouse for a couple months. So you can still do some things with a family, but certain things it's probably better to do before you have the family, because sometimes now I want to stay home.